according to the program is over, so I try to speed up a little bit. But my talk will not be on pulmonary atresia. Actually, this morning I didn't even know how to spell it. But hopefully I will be able to show you that this modeling can be of use in studying pulmonary atresia. This is the people that worked in this field, which I will show, and some funding and partners. Before I will talk about modeling, I would like to make a comparison with what is happening in, for instance, if you have a car engine. Nowadays, the modern car engine are equipped with computers that control the engine, right, that can control all kinds of parameters that make the engine work as good as possible. And for that, there is a control system. Actually, it's a computer. In new cars, there are many computers, as you may know, that controls the engine via all kind of input. And by measuring what the engine is doing, this system knows how to change the input to get a certain output. To do that, it needs to be able to predict what would be the outcome of changing the input. Otherwise, it would be just a random change of input. And this is called model predictive control. That means that the model decides how the process must be altered as it knows its state and it can predict its behavior. That's a nice system that works quite well in technology. If we transfer this to what we do in the clinic, of course, the process is a patient. And we can measure all kinds of things, and we've seen quite some interesting ways to measure data from the patient. So we know more or less the state. If we would have a predictive model that could tell us how to intervene and could predict the outcome, we would have the same kind of system. And that I would call model predictive clinical decision support. For that, of course, we need a model that predicts the outcome of intervention. And that's what I will talk about. So the model can support decisions on intervention as it knows the patient's state and can predict the behavior. So we will use predictive mathematical modeling of the human physiology to predict outcome of medical interventions by means of computer simulations and to come to clinical decision support. Well, this is not what I should do. This is. So there are quite some areas in which these models already play a role. One is on percutaneous coronary intervention. I will leave this for later because I will use this as an example during my talk. For instance, if you are interested in flow inside cerebral aneurysms, you can predict 4D, like 4D MR measurements, you can also predict the flow patterns. These are predictions, so you can compute that using simple laws of Newton, actually. And from this, of course, you could try to find out what would be the influence of, for instance, putting here a flow diverter to change the flow patterns. Also for aneurysms in the abdominal aorta, models are used now to predict predict what would be the stresses in the arterial wall to predict if it is prone to rupture or not, and then you can, based on that, decide whether or not to intervene. These are quite complex models and difficult to introduce in the clinic because it takes time. You need computers that are quite forceful, but you can also use simple models. And for that, I will take this example. So in order to make these models work in the clinic, you need quite some things to do. Of course, you have to define your problem. That's important, especially engineers. They need to know what is the real problem. Engineers tend to solve the wrong problem, especially if they work for medical doctors. So that's very important. Then in a preclinical phase, you have to develop the models. That's doing the mathematics. You have to verify them in some way. Then you have to characterize the materials. If we talk about hemodynamic models, we talk about the deformation of the arterial wall. And the arterial wall has a certain property. And these properties must be known in order to let these models quite well work. So this is material characterization. And then you have to implement them in such a way that you can go to a clinical phase. where the model must be introduced in the clinical workflow, which is quite tedious to do. More often you come to the conclusion that the model is not optimal enough to be used, so you have to go back. So that's model optimization. Then you have to personalize the model. So you have to feed the model with the input of the specific patient, not of the group of patients, but the specific patient. For that, you have to know which parameters are important, which are not important. So you have to do sensitivity and uncertainty analysis to do that. And in the end, you have to corroborate your model and show that indeed the model and the decision support that is related to that helps the patient. And then you can maybe also go to interface in which you make it a product and sell it, but that's for later. So this is what I will, during my talk, I will go through these few of these blocks. Let's first look at the definition phase, and now I take a coronary disease as an example. So here we see an angiogram of a coronary, two stenoses, this one probably severe, this one, I don't know. So the question is, what should we do? So the clinical decision can be do nothing, give any medication, place a stent or more stents, and do bypass surgery. That's kind of a decision you have to make. And question, of course, is what is the physiological relevance of such a coronary stenosis? In the clinic, then parameters are used. The CFR is the coronary flow reserve, is the ratio between the flow in hyperemic state through the stenosis divided by the flow in baseline. So if you are in rest. And that is called coronary the coronary flow reserve. And actually, it tells not only something about the stenosis, but also about the peripheral system. So if there's a lot of diffuse disease in the periphery, also this coronary flow reserve will change, even if the stenosis is not severe. So it's not a real good parameter. Another parameter is called fractional flow reserve, which is the flow in hyperemic state, so during hyperemia, in the stenosed case, divided by the virtual situation, the flow in hyperemic state, if there would be no stenosis. And of course, you cannot measure it, because the stenosis is there. The only way to measure that is to revascularize and measure it. But you want to know beforehand. So this is a nice parameter, tells something about the stenosis, but it's not measurable, at least. And there, a model can come into, can be helpful. And what I want to show here is that a model doesn't need to be complex. There's a famous quote, a designer knows he has achieved perfection, not when there's nothing left to add, but when there's nothing left to take away. And the same holds for a model. So a model, you shouldn't make a model complex and more complex. You should make it such a way that you cannot take anything away. It's more or less the same as Einstein's quote, model must be simple, but not too simple. That's what we do here. We define an FFR, which can be as we did before, but now we use the simple relation, actually the law of Ohm. We say that the resistance here is independent because we have a hyperemic state, so there's nothing to change there, and we can define the flow as the pressure gradient, the pressure here minus the pressure over there, divided by the resistance. That's the law of Ohm. And the same we can do in the non-stenosed case. Only then the pressure, the distal pressure, would be equal to the aortic pressure. And in that case, this fractional flow reserve is simple, the ratio between the pressure distal and the pressure proximal to the stenosis. And this can be measured. So we have a simple measure that tells us something about the sonority of the stenosis. And this is called FFRP, the pressure-derived FFR. It was introduced by Professor Peltz in some time ago. But this is a very simple model. Maybe it's too simple. So what we can do is we could try to make the model more complex, not because we like complex models, but to show that this simple model is good enough. And that's what we do. And now I will show you some equations. But look at them as if they are if these are images, like we saw some images in the previous. So I will get you through it. What we will do is we will assume that we have a piece of artery, like here. And in the artery, there's a core and a boundary layer. So close to the walls, there's friction of the blood flow in the wall. So there are friction forces. And in the core, there's not much friction because the wall is quite far away. But of course, I need a pressure gradient, a pressure force to accelerate and decelerate because our flow is dynamic. So to accelerate and decelerate, I need forces. So I need a pressure force both for the core and for the wall. And that's what we use. This is the equations that belong to that and can combine. And then we use a simple law, is that the flow that goes in this part minus the flow that goes out that part must be the volume change of the artery. That's conservation of mass. And then we have these forces. The sum of all forces is equal to the mass times the acceleration. That's the second law of Newton. Okay, for this you have to put it in more complicated equations because it's not one particle but many particles. And then you can solve that. And that is what is done. And then you can put all those kind of arteries next to each other. And we can have the pressure and flow in the arterial system, wherever you want to know it, as a function of time, depending on how big the arteries are, what the properties of the arteries are, etc. So this is a lump model in the sense that we lumped all information over a cross section of an artery into one parameter, mean velocity or flow and mean pressure. And this can help you, of course, to analyze your arterial system. Of course, you have to verify this. I will be very short on that. So you do experiments in the laboratory and you compare what you measure with this is the measured pressure and measured flow, and you see almost no difference between the measurements and the flow. So the model does quite well. So that gives us trust that we can use it. Next is material characterization. If I look at an artery, then the relation between the radius of the artery and the pressure is quite nonlinear. So if I increase the pressure, of course the radius of the artery will increase too. The artery will distend, but this is a nonlinear relation. The reason for that is that in these arteries we have collagen fibers. And these fibers, if the pressure is low, these fibers are more or less, wrinkled. And if the pressure is high, like here, these fibers are stretched. Once these fibers are stretched, the stiffness of the artery is much higher than when they are wrinkled. So that means that in the low pressure case, here we see these wrinkled arteries. This is a setup we did together with the people in Lausanne, measurement of collagen fibers, and now we increase the pressure. So we see that these fibers stretch and stretch, so we come in this area and it becomes stiffer and stiffer. So this must be put into the models if you want to have a good model. And that's what you can do, and that's what we did, and now I will go very fast because this is I should have skipped maybe these slides. We measure in coronary arteries of humans, but also of pigs, the pressure, radius and flow, and we find this relation. We take care that we stretch the artery in a proper way, because an artery is pre-stretched in longitudinal direction. And then we try to find the parameters that describe the stiffness of the artery. And once this is done, you can use this to come up with a simple relation of the compliance, which is the cross-sectional area divided by the pressure. Don't look at the equations. And then we can fit quite well how the behavior is. So we need only, and that's the conclusion of this work, we need only actually the inner diameter and the thickness of the wall to know how this artery will dilate due to a pressure change. And we can put that into the model. But now we have coronary arteries, and they are on the heart. So we have another problem to solve. We have to look at, go back to the model development, and we have to look at the heart itself. Also the heart, and this is the picture I want you to look at, is a muscle. And these muscles is built up of fibers. And all these fibers have a kind of relation, stretch, strain relation, as the collagen fibers are showed, but only active. They can contract. So we have to put this information into the arteries, and then you can do some mathematical things, That's not important, but the idea in the end is that you can lump the whole system, the whole heart, in a relation between the pressure in the left ventricle and the volume of the wall and the volume of the left ventricle. And inside here is some information you can get out of these computations I showed you. So there's a lumped parameter model of the heart relating the pressure in the left ventricle with the volume of the left ventricle. So you can make a pressure volume loop. Once you have this model, you can include this model in this arterial system and let the heart do its work and show what is going on. Here we see what this model can do. So this is the volumes. This is the volume of the left ventricle, the venous divided by 1,000. This is the pressure. You see a typical arterial pressure in the left ventricle and flow, and this is the PV loop you can get out of it. So you can use these models to complete the model. And then you can combine this heart model with this tree I showed you earlier and compute from this the pressure and flow in all the arteries and veins, but also in the coronary arteries and veins. And what is important for the coronary arteries is that at the end of the coronary arteries, the microcirculation is squeezed by the heart. So normally if pressure goes up in my systemic circulation, flow will go up. In the coronary artery, if pressure goes up, the heart squeezes the coronary arteries, so flow will go down. So there will be an out-of-phase relation between pressure and flow. Once you use these models, you can, for instance, predict what happens if you have a stenosis. So here's a stenosis in the LAD, and you can see, you can see quite interesting how in a patient the pressure will change if you open the stenosis. It will go up to quite normal values again. And the model predicts more or less the same behavior. This is before that the stent is placed, and this is after that the stent is placed. So the model can help you here to predict the outcome of intervention. What you can do then is also build an experimental setup to see if this simple model, this FFR we introduced earlier, indeed predicts what this complex model would predict. And this is done, and then here you see, for instance, the result. This is the FFR based on pressure measurements, so that's the real FFR. And this is the FFR based on flow measurements, and this goes quite well. So that's the moment that you can introduce the model into the clinic, and that's what we did. I call this model corroboration. And this ended up in a very nice paper of Pim Tonino, one of our PhD students, a famous study in which they showed that if you use this FFR as a guideline to intervene, then you can reduce the complications in, this is FFR-guided PCI against only angio-guided PCI. You reduce the complications by 30%, which is quite some result. So this is a very nice result. This is a very simple model. Okay, now I would like two slides to go maybe to what could be interesting also for this conference. What we also could do is look at a stenosis. In this case, an aortic valve stenosis. Then you can see that we have, again, the patient and the model. This is before intervention. So here we have the velocity measured in the coronary artery still, but with an aortic stenosis, and this is after the intervention, so it's quite normal pattern again. And the model predicts more or less the same. So also there, the model could predict what would be a possible outcome of intervention. For the lungs, of course, we need also to include lungs, but that can be done in a simple way, and let me then conclude with I tried to show you is we used a very simple model, in this case of the coronary circulation, a lumped model, that revealed a simple index, which is the FFR. We verified the model, which is a very important step. Then it was applied and validated in a clinical study. This is this FAME study I showed you. And it changed the guidelines to do intervention. And it also, and that's also important, is in the end cost saving. Because it's easy to develop technology and make technology more expensive. But of course, what we want to do is to make it also cheaper. And that's what I hope to learn in this conference from you, is that this model can be extended to study pulmonary hemodynamics and could be of interest for clinical decision support and pulmonary atresia as well. And with this, I would like to end, and hopefully I gained a little bit of time.